Hey there, I'm Cruzen, bringing you another episode from the KSP Quick Guide series. This video will cover everything you need to know about flying at high altitudes. High altitude flying is very useful and is the quickest and most efficient way to get around Kerbin without leaving the atmosphere. This is the last step before going to space. Understanding how your plane operates at high altitudes will make you a much better player, and the transition from planes to SSTOs from this point will be a breeze. So, let's get started. There is a fairly big difference between regular and high altitude designs. The most obvious changes will be swapping out the basic jets for turbojets. The basic jets are the more efficient and powerful of the two jet engines initially, but once you start flying higher and faster, you want to swap them out for turbos. The turbojet gets more efficient the higher you climb, meaning that its specific impulse, or ISP, is dependent on altitude. The thrust, however, is dependent on surface speed. Here's a graph that better illustrates these concepts. You can see that the turbo has its max specific impulse at 0.3 atmospheres, or at around 6,000 meters, and its maximum thrust comes when it hits 1,000 meters per second surface speed. Just stuff to keep in mind, but the basic gist of the matter is if you want to fly high and fast, slap on some turbos. For air intakes, the go-to selection is the ram air intake. It performs the best out of the three options and is designed for exactly what we're trying to do. The main thing to think about is if you'll need to angle your intakes at all. This is only really a concern if your plane doesn't have a lot of lift, which causes you to have to keep your nose well above your prorogate marker. The intakes work best when they are aimed directly at the direction of travel. If you need to pitch up less than 5 degrees, then I wouldn't worry about it. Mounting the air intakes can be tricky, but it mainly comes down to whatever you think looks good. You can use extra tanks, tail connectors, or structural parts like the cubic strut, which is my personal preference. You can place them anywhere, which is very handy, and they can easily be angled if you need them to be. On top of that, you can actually mount two intakes to them if you want, which is the basis for air hogging. I'll cover air hogging when we start talking about SSTOs though. Whatever you do, please, please don't mount your air intakes like this. I think it looks terrible. A good ratio to aim for with high altitude designs is about 1 to 3 air intakes per engine. The more you add, the higher you'll be able to climb, so feel free to add more if you feel like it. I typically add extra parts like this adapter to make things look nicer, but these parts add weight and drag, so keep that in mind. Something you won't have experience when flying at low altitudes is the dreaded flameout. Flaming out is when an engine runs out of the required amount of air to keep itself running. This causes it to shut down, and in almost every case this is a bad thing. There are some ways to design around this to make it less of an issue, but the easiest way to counter flaming out is to know your performance ceiling and understand how throttling down can actually prevent flaming out, up to a point. The basic rule of thumb when it comes to intake air for an engine is that it needs 0.1 units of intake air to continue running at max throttle. It can usually run a little below this if you want to push your luck, but typically once you hit 0.1 units, you should begin thinking about throttling back slightly to safely avoid flaming out. You can gauge what throttle you need to be at by thinking of the intake air value as a percentage of your throttle. For a single engine, this would mean 0.1 for 100% throttle, 0.05 for 50% throttle, and so forth. These give you a decent buffer and should keep you from flaming out. Multiply these values by however many engines you have, so 0.3 for 100% throttle with 3 engines, for example. Your plane gives some warning signs when it's about to flame out if you're climbing gradually. You can usually hear weird sounds start happening. Also, if you right-click your engines, you can actually see which engine is going to flame out by looking at which one has the lowest thrust. This will usually cause your plane to pull to one side and want to yaw, even though you haven't flamed out yet. You can use this sign as a good indicator that you need to throttle back. If you do flame out, you should instantly throttle down to hopefully kickstart the dead engine right away. At low throttle, you shouldn't be put into as much of a death spin. The other way to avoid major flameout issues is to design your plane using an odd number of engines. The reason behind this is that you can control which engine flames out first. The KSP chooses the last engine placed onto the plane as the first one to flame out. What this means is that if you place one engine on either wing first using symmetry, then place another engine on the tail of your plane, that tail engine will flame out first, which won't cause your plane to go into a flat spin. If you have an even number of engines, like two, one of the two engines will flame out first, which will instantly put you into a flat spin. This is a trick that I'm not sure a lot of people know about, so use it wisely. Having the middle engine flame out first lets you push the plane a little harder instead of trying to preemptively throttle down and avoid flaming out. With this system, you can just go until you flame out and then throttle down without risking any real major problems. Another way to avoid flat spinning is just to put a ton of reaction wheels on your plane. It's pretty cheesy, but it works. you're okay with that, then go for it. The last tricky thing about flying at high altitudes is the lower amount of atmosphere present. This means that your control surfaces will have less of an effect the higher you climb. You'll quickly find making small adjustments much harder. The ways to counter this are to either add more control surfaces or to add reaction wheels. I recommend a good blend of the two. Avoid going all out on control surfaces or all out on reaction wheels if you can. Although the Infiniglider characteristics of having tons of control surfaces can be kind of fun to play around with sometimes. I do see some designs that use RCS, but I don't support it for flying around in the atmosphere. RCS is primarily used in space, and even then you don't need it very often. I prefer using reaction wheels when I can, as they are lighter overall, and that's one less resource I need to worry about in the end. Alright, that covers about all the high altitude design aspects. I recommend starting out with a small single engine and 2-4 intakes, similar to this design. A single engine means we won't have flat spin problems if we flame out, which is great for learning how to control the throttle. The extra intakes will help us climb fairly high as well. Flying is fairly straightforward, and if you watched my previous plane tutorials, you should be a pro by now. The only issue to run into is the lack of control that I mentioned earlier. Depending on how many reaction wheels you have on your plane, your experience may vary. When you're first learning, I recommend climbing at a fairly shallow angle, like 45 degrees. Open up your resources tab and keep an eye on your intake air. At about 10 kilometers, you'll see it start to drop. I try to make sure that I'm flying within 5 to 10 degrees of horizontal by the time I hit 0.2 units of intake air. This gives me a little time to flatten out and also make sure I don't flame out too quickly. Ideally, you want to fly as long as you can at max throttle. Whatever altitude you hit that leaves you at 0.1 units of air at max throttle is what I call the acceleration ceiling. I have no clue what an actual term for this might be. You want to make sure you're flying perfectly horizontal at this point if you can, with as little vertical speed as you can. Aim for somewhere between 10 and negative 10 meters per second on the vertical speed gauge. Based on how much lift your plane has with respect to the weight of your plane, you might not be able to be pitched directly at the horizon. As I said earlier, if you find that you need to be pitched up more than 5 degrees, you might consider designing your intakes with a slight downward angle. The more direct contact they have while flying means you have more air to work with. After a while, you'll notice your acceleration decreasing. Once it gets slow enough, you can consider actually raising your altitude. This will require pitching up and watching out for flameouts. Throttle back accordingly as you climb, keeping an eye on your intake air in the Resources tab. Play around with leveling off as you climb to gain extra speed. As your acceleration slows down again, feel free to climb some more. The more you climb and the less throttle you have to use, the more efficient your flight becomes as you're burning less fuel, but flying as fast or faster than you were at a lower altitude. Typically, you can push this all the way to where you only have 1 to 2 ticks of throttle left. I call this the cruising ceiling, and this is where you'll spend most of your time flying. If your design is good enough, you might even be able to poke yourself into space. It will be a purely suborbital hop, as it is impossible to go fully into orbit without some form of rocket engine. If you find your cruising speed over 2100 meters per second surface velocity, or 2350 meters per second orbital, your apoapsis will slowly climb, even though you are flying horizontally. Fly like this long enough, and you'll eventually see your apoapsis climb to above 70 kilometers. Congratulations! This is the basic principle behind flying SSTOs, even though you won't be able to get to orbit just yet. The next video will be the SSTO tutorial, and I'll help you get that extra kick you need to get into orbit. It takes some tinkering, but if you've gotten this far with your plane design, then it will actually be pretty easy. As always, thanks for watching! If this video helped you out, please press the like button down below. Take it easy!